In this video, we're going to be looking at Robert Browning. He will be a useful figure because he will serve both as representative of a number of Victorian concerns. He was tremendously popular in the latter part of the 19th century, but also because he serves as a useful bridge to modernism, as indeed Matthew Arnold will as well, especially with Dover Beach. Browning's father had a very well-stocked home library, and so Browning, who was largely self-educated, was extremely widely read in a variety of different areas, although he tended to pursue his interests more than the kind of education that one would have if one received it primarily from a classical modern school. During the early part of his life, he was probably more famous as the husband of Elizabeth Barrett Browning, who was a tremendously successful author. And even if you don't realize it, you're familiar with some of her work. Sonnets from the Portuguese is one of her more popular publications, and it includes in it the sonnet that says, "How do I love thee? Let me count the ways," which is, of course, one of her more famous poems that has become a popular phrase. In fact, the relationship between Robert and Elizabeth Barrett Browning is one of the great love stories of the 19th century. Elizabeth Barrett Browning had an overbearing father who was convinced and convinced her that she was an invalid and kept her on a sofa swaddled in blankets for most of her life. But at age 30, she met an interesting young man named Robert who took her away from her parents, spirited her off to Italy, where they led a very happy life together. And although she did die very young, Robert Browning was apparently a very loving husband who took good care of his wife until she died and never remarried after her death. In the latter part of his life, Browning became tremendously popular, and he became sort of paradoxically popular with two different groups of people. One group of people was a group of little old ladies who just loved Mr. Browning and would have tea parties to which they would invite Mr. Browning and invite him to read his poems, which he always happily obliged. So he'd sit around with a bunch of little old ladies and read his poetry, who would just swoon with pleasure. But the other group of people who appreciated his poems also recognized that buried within those poems was a tremendous amount of doubt, an awareness of the growing isolation that people were feeling in society. And also, something that appealed to the modern poets later, his willingness to experiment with different forms, especially with meter and with sound. He has poems like Soliloquy of a Spanish Cloister that begins with a growl. The first word is literally grrr. And we'll be looking at some of those poems and talking about how they serve this experimental function. And though he didn't develop the form himself, Browning made the dramatic monologue format something that is associated with him and elevated it perhaps to a whole new level. And his greatest poems, in many cases, are this dramatic monologue format. Browning's first extended publication as a young man was a poem called Pauline, a Fragment. And John Stuart Mill, in an unpublished review, which Browning nevertheless somehow managed to get a hold of, called it filled with a morbid self-consciousness. And although the review was largely positive, Browning was stung by that evaluation of his persona as a writer and vowed never to write any more poems, and then began to write plays, which in some ways are more appropriate for the kind of person he felt himself to be. Someone who, unlike romantic poets, wasn't writing about his own self and his own feelings, at least directly, but was rather representing various different kinds of characters or presenting other kinds of scenes. And so as a result of his negative review by John Stuart Mill of his poem Pauline, he started writing plays. However, his plays were not terribly successful, not drawing large audiences, primarily because they tended to be what we call pocket dramas, plays that are really written to be read rather than to be performed. They tend to be very wordy with very little action and very little acting other than just simply speaking. And so his plays weren't very successful. So when he turned back to poetry, he incorporated his two formats. He started to create a form of poem, which is a fragment from a play. It's like a speech, a soliloquy, and that is the dramatic monologue. A dramatic monologue is a speech excerpted from a play in which you hear one person speaking to someone else who is present, who does not, however, respond in the poem. So in My Last Duchess, the Duke, Ferrara, is speaking to the emissary of a count who has a marriageable daughter whom the Duke hopes to wed. and he is making an appeal to this emissary about his proposed wedding to the daughter of this count. In The Bishop Orders His Tomb, it is a bishop on his deathbed who is speaking to his sons. If you know anything about Catholicism and Catholic priests, you right away will see one of the problems with this, about the kind of tomb he imagines himself having after his death. In Soliloquy of a Spanish Cloister, he has one monk complaining about another monk who is too pious and too pure, and thereby irritates the speaker of the poem, who is doing his very best to get Brother Lawrence's target damned to hell. A dramatic monologue is a poem in which a speaker speaks to a silent auditor and generally, usually, characterizes himself in some way by what he says, and usually unconsciously about how he comes across to his auditor. So, in Porphyria's Lover, the speaker is clearly insane. His girlfriend comes in from outside. He is feeling sorry for himself, sitting in the dark. She lights up the room, lights the fire, makes everything comfortable, and comes down and sits down by him and rests his head on her shoulder and tries to comfort him. But he's angry at her because she will not, as he says, vainer ties dissever, which means basically ties to anything that is not him. He demands her total and complete attention. He looks into her eyes, realizes that she does actually love him, but is just too weak to sever these vainer ties. And so he found a thing to do, which is he takes her long blonde hair, wraps it around her neck 3 times, strangles her to death, and then opens her eyes again, props her head on his shoulder, and thinks that he has satisfied her fondest wish, which is to give herself for him forever. And so he believes he has made her happy by killing her so that she can give him her total attention, which of course she doesn't have much of now because she's dead. And then the last line of the poem is, "And God has not said a word." So clearly the guy is insane. Now, we should not read this as some sort of externalization or displacement of Browning's own feelings toward his wife. He was obviously a very loving husband, but he was also interesting in exploring these alternative states of mind, which is one of the things that made him very appealing to modern poets, because when we look at the Love Song of Geoffrey Prufrock, we can clearly see the influence of poets like Browning, because Prufrock is a person who is speaking to an auditor, in this case I believe it's us, but nevertheless characterizing himself in ways that he intends us to understand and perhaps in ways that he doesn't. So Browning appealed to a modern sensibility, not only because of his way of representing odd and strange characters, but also because his willingness to experiment with sound and meter in ways that appeal to modern poets. And that differentiated him from more traditionally Victorian poets like Tennyson, whom we should be reading this semester. There is no excuse for excluding Tennyson, except that we simply don't have time. But Tennyson is probably the quintessential Victorian poet in a number of ways. So we're going to start off by looking at some of the poems that exemplify Browning's experimental use of sound and meter. And then we're going to move into his dramatic monologues and look specifically at My Last Duchess and how that poem works to characterize its speaker unconsciously. So let's start by looking at Browning's experimental use of rhyme and meter. And for our first example, let's look at the poem How They Brought the Good News, which is based upon a fictional incident, but it's supposed to represent something like the famous Midnight Ride of Paul Revere, or the incident that originated the marathon running 26 miles to deliver news of a battle. Now, in order to understand how this poem works, you have to understand something about how horses travel. And Browning himself was an accomplished horseman. A horse has 3 basic gaits: a walk, a trot, and a lope or canter. A walk is a 4-beat gait. Each foot hits the ground separately. It's bump, 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 bump. A trot is a 2-beat gait, and opposing feet hit the ground at the same time. So it's bump, 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 bump. A lope or a canter, which is sometimes called a gallop, is a 3-beat gait. Both hind feet hit at the same time, then the inside front foot, then the outside front foot. So it's bum, 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 bum. This poem is about men delivering news on running horses, so it follows the beat of a loping, or in this case, galloping horse. You'll notice how it follows that meter, three beats. I sprang to the stirrup, and Joris and he, I galloped, Dirk galloped, we galloped all three. Good speed, cried the watch as the gate bolts undrew. Speed echoed the wall to us galloping through. Behind shut the postern, the lights sank to rest, and into the midnight we galloped abreast. So each line has two three-beat metrical feet, like a horse galloping. On page 336, we find a toccata of Galuppi's, and a toccata is a piano composition called a touch piece, and it is designed to show off the manual dexterity of the pianist, the ability to hit keys quickly and lightly. In this poem, the poet is listening to a piano performance of a touch piece by Galuppi, but also attempting to replicate in words the sound of a toccata, a touch piece. It moves very quickly with very smooth, flowing, metrical feet. O Galuppi Baldassaro, this is very sad to find. I can hardly misconceive you, it would prove me deaf and blind, but although I take your meaning, 'tis with such a heavy mind. Here you come with your old music, and here's all the good it brings. What they lived once thus at Venice, where the merchants were the kings, where St. Mark's is, where the doges used to wed the sea with rings. So again, it's quick, short, smooth, metrical arrangement. He's trying to replicate the sound of a piano piece. Another experimental poetic form that Browning works with is the attempt to replicate spoken speech in a rhymed poem. So if we look at Soliloquy of a Spanish Cloister, which in itself is an entertaining poem because the poet is attempting to create a circumstance where we hear the internal monologue of a monk who hates another monk and is trying to get him damned to hell, and at the same time clearly shows that the person who belongs in hell is the speaker, because everything he tries to pin on the other monk, he himself is already guilty of. For instance, he believes that looking at a scrofulous French novel will instantly damn one's soul to hell. But of course, it's his scrofulous French novel. He already owns it, so clearly he's looked at it, so he's already being damned to hell. And he's planning to slip it into the cover of a Bible so that when Brother Lawrence opens his Bible, he'll see this novel and then be damned as a result. So in this poem, he is attempting to replicate this internal monologue of someone who's actually speaking. And so the poem starts off with a growl. Grr, there go my heart's abhorrence. What are your damned flower pots do? If hate killed men, Brother Lawrence, God's blood would not mine kill you. What, your myrtle bush wants trimming? Oh, that rose has prior claims? Needs its leaden vase filled brimming? Hell dry you up with its flames. At the meal we sit together, salve tibi I must hear, wise talk of the kind of weather, sort of season, time of year. Not a plenteous court crop, scarcely. Dare we hope oat galls, I doubt? What's the Latin name for parsley? What's the Greek name for swine's snout? And anyway, this is an attempt to replicate in a poem the internal speech of this angry and very hostile speaker. But nevertheless, to do it, if you'll notice, in rhymed couplets, abhorrence and Lawrence, do and you, trimming and brimming, claims and flames. So the broken and uneven meter of the lines hides the fact that this is written in rhymed couplets. Next, let's look at Childe Roland to the Dark Tower Came, to look at a slightly different side of Browning's poetry. This poem is based upon a chivalric quest romance, similar to the one represented in the Middle English poem, Sir Gawain and the Green Knight, in which Gawain is forced to prove his loyalty and bravery by going out on a quest which he knows will end in his own death. In a chivalric quest romance, a knight is sent off in some way to prove his loyalty, courage, resourcefulness, or some other chivalric quality by achieving some goal, finding the Holy Grail, defeating the dragon, something along those lines. However, this one is a much more bleak and bitter image of that kind of journey. The poem is based upon a crazy song from King Lear that Edgar, son of Gloucester, sings while he is pretending to be crazy and is hiding from his father who has wrongly accused him of treason at the urging of his stepbrother. And he sings this song, "Child Roland to the dark tower come, his word was still, fie, fo, and fum, I smell the blood of a British man." The title Child is the title of a young man of noble birth who, in this case, is aspiring to knighthood. However, Child Roland, in this case, in his quest, knows that he is just going to fail, as he says in the fourth stanza. On his journey, once he realizes he's on the path to the Dark Tower, his quest, his heart leaps because he's finding failure in its scope. And all he hopes for is to fail as well as those who have gone before. He hopes he's fit to be no worse a failure than they are. So this is a very bleak poem about someone who is traveling through an incredibly bleak landscape on a mystical quest, which he knows is bound to fail. One of the reasons that this poem seemed to be celebrated by modernist poets was not only because of its ambiguity and because of its bleak and desolate tone, but also because it employs a traditional structure, the chivalric quest romance, in terms of conveying a more modern message, which is true of James Joyce in Ulysses and even Prufrock in his love song, which takes us on a journey to a sense of failure. Now let's look at My Last Duchess, which is an example of a dramatic monologue. And as I explained earlier, a dramatic monologue is a poem which is like a speech taken from a play. It's actually sort of excerpted from the play. And we hear the speaker speaking to someone else who is present in the poem, although that person does not usually respond, although they may act in some way, and we'll see the speaker respond to their action, as actually happens in this poem. And in the poem, the speaker unconsciously characterizes himself. He gives us an image about who this person is, and sometimes in unflattering ways, ways that this person would not necessarily want us to see them. Think about it as though you met someone for the first time, say at a bar. You're sitting at the bar and some guy walks up to you and says, "How you doing?" and sits down and asks if they can buy you a drink. And as they start to talk, you start to realize that this person is an egomaniacal maniac with a completely inflated sense of their own importance and attractiveness. And so that's kind of what a dramatic monologue is. That person wouldn't want you to see that, but nevertheless is unable to prevent you from reading through the way they talk in order to understand who they really are. And a dramatic monologue is most often a speaker characterizing themselves in that same sort of way. So in this poem, we have the Duke of Ferrara. Ferrara is the name of a place, but it also happens to be the name of the Duke of that place. It's his title. And this is the equivalent of that line in a play where it identifies the speaker. So it says Hamlet, colon, and then Hamlet says something, and then it says King, and Claudia says something. So this is Ferrara speaking. In this poem, the speaker is characterizing his late wife, whom he calls My Last Duchess, describing her to the emissary of a count who has a marriageable age daughter, whom the speaker, the Duke, hopes to wed. He is meeting with this man to arrange a marriage with the young daughter of the count. And during this speech, he is leading the emissary on a tour through his art gallery, showing him his various works of art, among which is a painting of his late wife. And in the poem, we will not only get an implicit description of his late wife, but also an explanation of why his late wife was unsatisfactory to him, what happened to her, and also an implicit notion of what impression his speech makes upon the emissary to whom he is delivering this monologue. "That's my last duchess painted on the wall, looking as if she were alive. I call that piece a wonder now, for all Pandolf's hands worked busily a day, and there she stands. Will it please you sit and look at her? I said Frau Pandolf by design, for never read strangers like you that pictured countenance, the depth and passion of its earnest glance. But to myself they turned, since none puts by the curtain I have drawn for you but I, and seemed as they would ask me if they durst, how such a glance came there. So, not the first are you to turn and ask thus. What's going on in this particular section of the poem? Obviously, we are standing next to the Duke, in the person of this emissary of the Count, in front of a painting of his late Duchess. And we know that she's his late Duchess because he says last Duchess, and also we know that the Duke is trying to arrange for the marriage of his next Duchess, and he says looking as if she were alive. So clearly that implies she's not alive. So what is the significance of his description of the Duchess? Now, God forbid, should my spouse pass away, and should I show you a picture of the spouse, I am going to be remembering my spouse and all her glorious qualities and why she made my life so wonderful and all of those things. However, that's not what Ferrara is focusing on. Ferrara is focusing on the fact that he has a Fra Pandolf original painting of his wife. The same way one might say, look, I have a Picasso over my mantelpiece. He's focusing upon the quality of the painting. He says, I call that piece a wonder now. Fra Pandolf's hands worked busily a day, and there she stands. And so he's calling attention to the name of the painter. It's a famous painter in a commissioned painting. And so he wants to call attention to the fact that I was able to afford having a famous painting paint a picture of my young wife. So they're going to sit and look at the painting. Will it please you sit and look at her? I said Fra Pandolf by design. So he's telling us he intentionally revealed that this is Fra Pandolf's work. For never read strangers like you that pictured countenance, the depth and passion of its earnest glance. But to myself they turned, since none puts by the curtain I have drawn for you but I, and seemed as they would ask me if they durst how such a glance came there. So in other words, he's explaining that the beauty of the Duchess is the work of Fra Pandolf's hands. Sir, 'twas not her presence only called that spot of joy into the Duchess's cheek. Perhaps Fra Pandolf chanced to say, her mantle laps over my lady's wrist too much, or paint must never hope to reproduce the faint half-flesh that dies along her throat. Such stuff was courtesy, she thought, and cause enough for calling up that spot of joy. She had a heart, how shall I say, too soon made glad, too easily impressed. She liked whatever she looked on, and her looks went everywhere. Sir, 'twas all one. My favor at her breast, the dropping of the daylight in the west, the bough of cherries some officious fool broke in the orchard for her, the white mule she rode with round the terrace, all in each would draw from her alike the approving speech, or blush at least. She thanked men, good, but thanked, somehow, I know not how, as if she ranked my gift of a 900-years-old name with anybody's gift. Who'd stoop to blame this sort of trifling? Even had you skill in speech, which I have not, to make your will quite clear to such a one and say, just this or that in you disgust me, here you miss or there exceed the mark. And if she let herself be lessened so, nor plainly set her wits to yours forsooth and made excuse, even then would be some stooping, and I choose never to stoop. Oh, sir, she smiled no doubt whenever I passed her, but who passed without much the same smile? This grew, I gave commands, then all smiles stopped together. There she stands as if alive. Will it please you rise? We'll meet the company below then. I repeat, the count your master's known munificence is ample warrant that no just pretense of mine for dowry will be disallowed, though his fair daughter self, as I avowed at starting, is my object. Nay, we'll go together down, sir. Notice Neptune, though, taming a seahorse, thought a rarity, which Klaus of Innsbruck cast in bronze for me. All right, so the first question one must ask here is, what happened to his late Duchess? Why is she the late Duchess and not the current Duchess? And the Duke makes it quite clear what has happened to her. In fact, he seems to be not only bragging about his artwork, but also his ability to kill people with impunity. So he says, this grew, I gave commands, then all smiles stopped together. So the Duke has her killed. Why does he have her killed? Well, he spends some time explaining what is wrong with his Duchess's behavior. The problem is, of course, that she pays attention to things which are not him. Her obligation as a Duchess is to reflect and glorify the wonder that is the Duke. That's her job, to reflect back to him what a wonderful man he is, not to pay attention to anything else. And the Duke apparently thinks that anything other than this, anything other than reflecting back his own glory to him, is the equivalent of her being unfaithful. And there are several implications here that he sees her as being unfaithful, although there is no evidence in the poem offered, and the Duke doesn't even seek to offer any evidence that she is unfaithful. Had she actually been unfaithful, had she actually been sleeping around, he would have had a much easier justification at that time in history for having her executed. Witness King Henry VIII. A couple of his wives were killed for infidelity, and the Duke has absolute power. So if he had such evidence, he certainly would bring it. But he does suggest that there is something inappropriate in her behavior, and that inappropriate behavior is the equivalent of infidelity. He says, she liked whatever she looked on, and her looks went everywhere, which suggests that she has a wandering eye. But then what evidence does he offer of her wandering eye? Sir, 'twas all one, means everything was the same to her. My favor at her breast, in other words, our romantic relationship, the dropping of the daylight in the west. The guy is jealous of the sunset. Now, clearly, she is not sleeping with the sunset. This isn't a Greek poem where the sunset is embodied in some sort of human person. She's actually enjoying the sunset, and he's jealous of that. The bough of cherries some officious fool broke in the orchard for her. She's grateful for someone bringing her cherries. The white mule she rode with round the terrace. He's jealous of the white mule that she enjoys to ride. All and each would draw from her alike the approving speech, or blush at least. He's jealous of things that draw her attention away from him. Why? Because he believes he should be the center of her orbit. She shouldn't be paying attention to anything else. She thanked men, good, but thanked somehow, I know not how, as if she ranked my gift of a 900 years old name with anybody's gift. So, my glorious name of the Duke of Ferrara, I generously conveyed upon her, and she doesn't value it any more than anything else. So, what kind of person is this ingrateful Duchess who obviously deserves to be killed? Well, we get some implicit description of her behavior. For one thing, we're told that she's pretty, but we're also told in lines 8 and 9 that she is deep, passionate, and earnest. And anyone who knows anything about Victorian culture knows that those are three very highly valued qualities: depth, passion, by which Victorians meant enthusiasm, and earnestness. And earnestness is such an important quality to Victorians that Oscar Wilde even makes fun of Victorians' desire for earnestness in his play, The Importance of Being Earnest, which lampoons Victorian earnestness. The depth and passion of its earnest glance. She's deep, passionate, and earnest. She's modest, because when Fra Pandolf points out her beauty by saying, her mantle laps over my lady's wrist too much, or paint must never hope to reproduce the faint half-flush that dies along her throat, such stuff was courtesy, she thought, and cause enough for calling up that spot of joy. And then she's also enthusiastic. She had a heart, how shall I say, too soon made glad, too easily impressed. And she's grateful. She thanked men. So she's beautiful, passionate, earnest, deep, grateful, enthusiastic. So by Victorian standards, it seems like Browning is having the Duke describe the perfect woman. He kills her because her perfection in all other aspects does not compensate for the fact that she fails to recognize his own glory, which she's supposed to reflect back to him. So why doesn't the Duke just say to her, dear, I'm sorry. I know you're young. You don't understand. You see, I am wonderful. I am glorious. I should be the center of your world. Everything you do should be directed not only to me, but toward making me happy and making me feel good about yourself. Now, I know you're young and naive, but the sooner you recognize how wonderful I am and how unimportant you are, everything will be so much better. So why doesn't he just sit her down and tell her this? Because apparently she's a nice, young, earnest, passionate person and grateful, and so maybe she'll listen to him. No, he won't tell her. He says, "Who'd stoop to blame this sort of trifling? Even had you skill in speech, which I have not, to make your will quite clear to such a one, and say, just this or that in you disgust me, here you miss or there exceed the mark. And if she let herself be lessened so, even if she was willing to listen to what I said and to change her behavior, and did not plainly set her wits to yours and made excuse, so even if she accepted what I said to her, even then would be some stooping, and I choose never to stoop. So it is beneath me to have to explain to her my own glory. She should simply know that. And to have to explain to her my own glory would be tremendously humiliating to me. And I'd rather not be humiliated. You know, it's really just easier to have her killed." So he has his wife killed because, despite all her wonderful qualities, she does not magnify his own glory. To what extent does he feel sorry for his action? Well, clearly he doesn't feel very sorry about it because he's bragging about it to the emissary of his next wife, as ill-advised as that may seem to be. But also, he seems to believe that his late wife is actually a more effective duchess when she's dead than she was alive. He says, not, "That's a painting of my last duchess on the wall," but, "That's my last duchess on the wall," as though he can't really differentiate between her and her image. And also, she's much more effective because instead of people turning to talk to her when they are introduced to the live duchess, when they look at the painting, they have to turn and talk to him. "For never read strangers like you, that pictured countenance, the depth and passion of its earnest glance, but to myself they turn." So now she's redirecting her attention to him. "Since none puts by the curtain I have drawn for you but I," because he is able to control her appearance. In other words, he can show her to whom he wants, and then immediately on looking at the painting, they have to turn to him. So now she's much more effective as a duchess. He's much happier as a duchess dead than he was alive. And for his purposes, there doesn't seem to be much difference between her dead and alive. Now, he is talking to the emissary of the count, who is the father of his proposed next bride. He goes on to make it clear that what he is really looking for here is her dowry. He says, "I repeat, the count, your master's known munificence, is ample warrant that no just pretense of mine for your dowry will be disallowed, though his fair daughter self, as I vowed at starting, is my object." So this is a great example of periphrasis. Periphrasis, peri means around, phrasis means speaking, language, words. So this literally is talking around it. He's trying very carefully not to say what he means. What he means is that you're going to give me the money, right? I'm going to get the money, right? That's what he means. But what he says is, "The count, your master's known munificence," munificence means generosity, "is ample warrant," you know what a warrant is, a warranty, a guarantee, "is sufficient guarantee that no just pretense of mine for dowry will be disallowed." So the count's generosity will guarantee that I'll get whatever dowry I ask for, though his fair daughter's self, as I avowed at starting, is my object. After this speech, there are two ways to read what happens. "Nay, we'll go together down, sir," which seems to suggest that the emissary gets up to leave. Now, he might get up to leave because he's running away from this crazy duke. I like to think that that's the case, that the duke has, in describing his late duchess, also characterized himself as an undesirable husband. And the emissary says, "I'm not having anything to do with you anymore. I'm leaving." And the count stops him and says, "We'll walk together down." But there's another possibility, which is simply that the count has already said, "We'll meet the company below then," so that they're getting ready to leave, and the emissary gets up to leave, and the Duke, as a sign of noblesse oblige, says, "We'll walk down together," because there is a very careful protocol for how one walks downstairs. In the company of different social classes, the upper classes go upstairs first, followed by the lower classes, and the lower classes go downstairs first, followed by the upper classes. So by saying, "We'll go together down, sir," he's inviting the man to walk downstairs arm in arm with him, which would be a concession to the emissary. But on the way, they pass through the rest of his art gallery, and he points out his other works in addition to his Last Duchess. Notice Neptune, though, taming a seahorse, thought a rarity, which Klaus of Innsbruck cast in bronze for me. So they walk by a bronze statue of Neptune taming a seahorse. So there's my last wife, the Duchess. Here's my statue of Neptune taming a seahorse. Also, by the way, others have pointed out that a seahorse is a magical fairy-like creature, and Neptune is an image of power. He is, after all, the god of the sea. This is implicitly recognizing that the powerful Duke has tamed his fairy-like seahorse, his Last Duchess, by having her killed. One has to wonder how the little old ladies who hosted Browning tea parties and let Mr. Browning come read their poems managed to miss these particular poems and their much less positive images. Browning did have many, many poems in his huge body of work that support the argument that he is cheerful and asserts a sense of faith in the goodness of the universe. But then there are also those poems that now tend to appeal more to the modern and postmodern sensibility that seem to recognize that the world is often a meaningless and hostile place.